It's a hot take. So I have a hot take for you.
My hot take? Well, I think some artists need to put a little more energy in their live set.
Overly complicated tracks are things that that kind of ruin a track for me.
Don't stick to any kind of genre label.
Future bass is the worst music genre ever created.
Barber beats was the original vaporwave.
Fuck General MIDI choir. It's all bad.
Bruh.
Worst album artwork I've ever seen is Green Day's Father of All Motherfuckers, probably.
I find new music often, and I usually illegally download it.
Stuff that sounds good.
Sample is vaporwave. It's still vaporwave, buddy.
MIDI wave is a form of vaporwave. Deal with it.
Gen Z is the future of vaporwave. I said it.
What is your musical guilty pleasure, vaporer?
It's gotta be K-pop.
You don't like mint chocolate chip ice cream? You are a baby.
Music isn't real.
I smell weed.
I'm Dan Mason.
This is Vape Eric.
This is FM Skyline.
This is Mesh.
Yo, this is Groovy Kaiju.
This is Christ. You're listening to
Hot Takes.
That's the one.
Don't touch my records. Ever.
Hey, welcome to Hot Takes, everybody. It is I, Young Shiro.
Hello.
Along with my illustrious cohort, Dr. Skeleton Lipstick. We want to welcome you to the preeminent Vaporwave talk show on the internet. 2 years strong, Hot Takes is a space for all opinions. I see a lot of first-time chatters in here. What's up, you guys? I see some regulars from the Discord server and some longtime friends in chat. Have we got a hell of an episode for you guys tonight. We have a longtime Vaporwave and Vaportrap OG, King Quartz, who agreed to join us tonight. Oh, there's our track ID wasn't working. My goodness! Woo! Wouldn't be Hot Takes without some tech issues.
Get me in there.
Yeah.
Get me in there.
We'll get King Quartz in pretty soon, but we want to thank you guys all for being here. Keep the questions in chat rolling for King Quartz. Remember, you guys are our top priority, aside from our guest tonight. Let us know if the music's too loud, if Chris's mic is too low, anything, all of the above. Any emojis that you place in chat will show up across the screen, so let those emojis fly. We heard you, King Quartz, I think. Yeah. Just a couple things.
Can the chat hear me?
Yeah. We'll bring you on and we'll start chatting Hot Takes after the intro. The fact is, I've been wanting to get King Quartz on the show for a long time, so you guys are in for a treat. I'd like to get started just by letting you guys know about some of the CloudBot commands y'all can use during the show. I'm going to just go ahead and use them all right now. Exclamation point Shiro allows you to get a link to my link tree. Exclamation point Skelly allows you to get a link to Skelly's link tree. Exclamation point donate allows you to follow the link to donate to the show. No pressure, but all donations go straight to the show, commissioned art, and just improving the show for the community. Discord, exclamation point, Discord. Link to the Discord server. Jump in the Discord server, guys. We argue about all kinds of fun and honestly dumb shit all the time. It's great. We would love to have you guys in there. Just be nice, don't be a dick, and don't be annoying. Otherwise, everyone is welcome. I can't remember the last command, but we'll go ahead and jump in with some recommendations, courtesy of me. The first recommendation I have for everybody tonight, as far as albums that you guys should check out, is actually an album by a former guest, Mr. Hotel Pools. Probably the best known...
Oh, yay! Love
great that. Guy. Probably the best known chill synth artist in the scene, other than Home Resonance fame. Hotel Pools has quite an impressive discography under his belt already, and I wanted to give a special shout out to his full-length album, Still, which is just a classic, vibey, 80s influence, just chill, demagnetized, tape warble filled, very fun experience. If you're not familiar with Hotel Pools, you got to check them out, especially if you like any sort of 80s influenced music. If you're a fan of Windows 96, FM Skyline, hopefully I'm not telling anybody anything new here. Check out Still by Hotel Pools. And along those lines, I've been really riding that chill synth wave. My favorite artist in the entire scene, I don't know if you've heard him, Chris, is a guy named Hello Meteor.
Oh, yeah. Hello Meteor is really wonderful. Very pensive stuff. A little bit slower than some of the, a little bit more build-ups and like growth than some of the stuff that gets right into the drums. I love Hello
I would
Meteor.
Use that word. Absolutely pensive. He's very good at creating soundscapes and just creating like a sound to fill an imagined space, right? Like he does a lot of like imagined
that.
Soundtracks. Me too, man. And his music is just beautiful. It's so damn poignant and gentle. My only beef is that sometimes the mastering is a little low. His albums can be a little on the quiet side, like the opposite of Carpenter Brute, you know? But I like to recommend this specific album. He's got a hell of a lot of albums. Recommend an album called Dusk Aquarium. I mean, with a title like that, how can you ignore a Dusk Aquarium? And if you like 80s-influenced music that's a little on the gentler side, definitely check out Hello Meteor's Dusk Aquarium. Beautiful stuff. And as a last... Oh, my goodness. Every time I open up iTunes, it just glitches out. As a last recommendation for the night, I want to recommend just kind of a left-field album that I... Actually, I'm sure you've heard, Chris... A little-known witch house act called Fraunhofer Diffraction.
Oh, I love Fraunhofer Diffraction.
Me
very,
too.
Very, very much like a lot of like kind of wave textures in that and that kind of music, too. I'm a big fan of Fraunhofer
Me, too. Diffraction. And the guy is very skilled. He even makes lo-fi house, too. I don't know if you know that. He's got a lot of different projects under his belt. But the album, A Place to Drown the Dreams, has got a couple tracks. Right, it's got a track that
I'm familiar with the
set.
Album.
Good but, stuff. You know, I'm glad to hear that you co-sign.
Oh, I mean, I'm very, very much into like witch house and wave music.
Chris and I are both big fans. So if you like wave music, if you like dark or angry or creepy hip hop influenced music, or you just know what witch house is,
ambient trap is so fun.
There's some good. I love all the textures. Done some of that too. A Place to Drown the Dreams is definitely on kind of like the louder, like traditional witch house side, and I can't recommend it enough. Fraunhofer Diffractions,
Great.
A Place
Co-sign
to Drown the
Dreams.
Co-sign
that one for sure. Co-sign that one
Good
for sure.
stuff, man. So with that being said, we're going to go and get into Skelly's hot take for the evening.
All right. So I guess my hot take right now is that I was just thinking back to the days, not too long ago, but the early 2010s, and what I miss the most... that's adjacent to music, but not exactly the music itself, are blogs. You know what I mean?
Yeah, me too.
I miss the written word. I miss the people taking the time to think about music and illustrate their thoughts about it using sentences. And, you know, that today, basically, it's just a lot of playlists, and maybe there's people on YouTube giving opinions, but I really love the idea of people kind of sitting down and taking time to sketch out what they think of the music, how they feel about it, what it reminds them of, what they like about it, and to actually putting that down into like paragraph forms. And it's so sad that I feel like we've lost that, right? You know, we don't really go to a lot of blogs anymore for that sort of thing. And I feel like I wish that would come back, you know?
Yeah.
Because really the thing about having a blog and writing your opinions of music is that that's kind of where you develop, you know, the tastemakers and the cultural influencers, you know what I mean? The culture critics themselves. And it's fine. The YouTube videos are fine. The playlists are fine. But
yeah,
I really feel like you hone your skill as someone who is an aficionado or someone with taste by writing these things out. You know what I mean? And I wish there was a way to get back to that time period. I wish that we could get blogs going again, because I think it's important. And also it's really great for press kits. For artists too, when somebody writes something about them in a blog. I remember when I was first getting started with Skeleton Lipstick, my one goal was like, I want one person to write about my music.
Right.
And then after that, everything else could be extra. And then they did, someone did. And then more people did. And I have a bunch of old press from the early 2010s, which is great. But I think it's sad that we don't have that anymore. Or we don't have it as much anymore. And I feel like that's sort of where, you know, like, and if you going to write a blog and you're going to critique music, you don't actually have to, you know, be hard on people. You know, what you do is that you the stuff you like is what you write about. You know
yeah,
I mean?
Yeah. Good point.
Because obviously we can go to Rate Your Music and that's kind of, you know, bloggy, right? With people's opinions,
yeah.
But it's, But there's a lot of negative stuff there too. What I want is somebody running a blog that is taking the things they love and expounding upon why they love them. You know what I mean?
I feel that.
And you can go and becoming a trusted source for opinions and music. You know, that's the thing, is that, you know, having strong opinions and putting them down in words, that's important. That gives you credibility. That gives you,
yeah.
It makes you an interesting figure. You know, it makes you somebody that people want to look to understand, you know, for some guidance about what,
yeah,
where to check interesting art out at. And my hot take is just that we don't have enough blogs anymore. You know what I mean? We're too dependent on playlists. We're too dependent on, I guess, mostly just playlists now, right? I mean,
algorithms.
YouTube videos are so annoying. You know what I mean? And I really wish that we had blogs again. Maybe one day I'll do a blog.
I mean, honestly, I understand why playlists and algorithms have their place. I used to write, as you know. Maybe I need to put that in the hot takes brain. What do they call it? When you're just trying to like figure out ideas, brainstorm. Maybe I need to put that in the brainstorm document I have. I mean, when I used to write, it's very time consuming. Yeah. You know.
Yeah, that's what I was about to say. I mean, I understand that's the thing. It's very time consuming.
Yeah.
And it's really, really. You can really feel dejected when you just put so much time into writing something and you just don't get a lot of people following it. It's so much work.
Yeah.
And I get it. I understand, but why? But still miss it. Still wish they would come back. Still wish someone would take up that mantle.
Well, shit, maybe.
Become a culture critic. And I have no time.
I want to say Utopia District does some of that.
Utopia District does that.
I'm not 100% sure, but I feel like, yeah.
Some Bleach Media, are they still around? They do it.
Listen Magic Corp.
Listen Corp still does it occasionally, yeah. Right? So, you know, they're out, and they do great jobs.
It's there if you want to find it, but it does need a resurgence. I do agree.
There's got to be a way to make it resurge again. It's so important to have these things.
I guess we better bring on our guest and see what they think about that, huh?
Sure.
Maybe I should take the screensaver down since they don't think their camera works. All right, King Quartz. Sorry, I guess I thought I gave a pretty adequate explanation of how we do our intro, but we're gonna take the screensaver down and you're gonna be on camera in a second. You ready?
Yeah.
Damn. Yeah. What in the world? Okay, so he's on camera. What is that you've got on your face, dog? Is that just what he looks like? Sick. I wonder if this is an idea of what it looks like to see King Quartz live.
I'm just talking with y'all.
Yeah.
I'm just doing my thing.
Hell yeah. Oh, sick.
And then I just like to say this. I love y'all.
Oh, yo. Oh, let me turn you up a little bit.
Such a sweetheart.
That's too cool, dog.
But
imagine.
I love
there's
done
the boy.
With all that.
I imagine that gets a little hot.
Big face reveal.
Face reveal. I've wanted to have you on my show for so long, so thank you so much for being here, for being willing to join
us
tonight. We've got a lot of viewers in chat, so you guys are welcome to let your questions rip as soon as you feel like it. But I just want to say, if you're not familiar with King Quartz and you like Vaporwave or Vaportrap, you need to check out Recycle Bin for sure. Yeah. Which I don't think is the... between the two, the one with the quartz on it, the name of it is escaping me at the moment. I feel like it's probably the bigger of the two.
Neo-Tokyo.
Neo-Tokyo,
yeah.
That's right. I loved Recycle Bin.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, because I never really released that, officially. It was more of a digital thing, because it was so sample-based that, I didn't... Yeah, I didn't want to put it out on a bunch of physical things and then get a bunch of problems. You know,
I know some people that feel exactly the same way.
Yeah.
Once you put a bunch of sampled material out in a physical form, I guess it is a little scary sometimes.
Yeah.
But I definitely recommend anyone in chat who hasn't heard Recycle Bin, the intro track is an absolute banger. It just goes right in. Great experience, start to finish.
I wasted no time. I was just like, let's go right, let's get right into it.
That is a fact. And Neo-Tokyo definitely has more of a vapor wave vibe, in my opinion. Recycle Bin is kind of more along the vapor trap. Pacific yeah. Plaza and was then, our first question, but go ahead, finish your thought, my guy.
Oh, I released something in 2020 called the 33rd Split.
Yeah, that's right. That album a lot.
And that's like a mixture of like goth and like vaporwave.
There
are some vocals on that album too. Is that you?
Yep, that's me.
Oh, I love it. That's
the deepest voice in vaporwave.
I really enjoy that album a lot. And you can totally pick up on like the hypnagothic vibe for it. You know what I mean?
Hypnagothic. There's a word.
Yeah.
Yeah, I actually like that. I actually dig that.
We need and that more was, of that.
Yeah, I try and do a little bit of that too with some of my songs. So I really appreciate what you're doing with that sort of vaporwave, but still with like this kind of interesting sort of like gothy sort of vibe that's underlying the sort of mist of the sounds around it. It was a good album.
Yeah, well, we're going to start pinning questions, but I want to know what you think about what Chris said about blogs. Did you read a lot of blogs? Did you write any blogs? Any thoughts?
Yeah, I was in the chat and like watching the chat like while we were while y'all were talking about blogs. And what I used to do is like, I don't know if anyone's ever read The Romance of the Three Kingdoms.
No, I wish.
Either. No, I don't know what that. What's that?
It's about like the ancient history of like feudal like military China.
Interesting.
Okay.
And so like I fell in love with that. So my Zanga, like when I was like a 14-year-old, being like a 14-year-old weird little like German boy, was like writing shit on like message forums, like message boards, message boards, and just writing like these stories about like, what if these like Chinese like military leaders were little kids? Like, how would they have played?
That's fucking fascinating. Okay, an unfinished children's story. All right, I'll take that.
Yeah. So it's like I was like 14, but like I just loved like have you guys ever played like Dynasty Warriors?
I'm familiar with it, but no.
Yeah, but it's just all about like all these like great military like Chinese leaders from the era of Three Kingdoms. And all
word,
like
word.
and you just fight as those characters. And so like I just like read the book itself.
And I gotcha.
Then was like I'm gonna write these battles, like these great magnificent military battles, as if it was little kids playing with like paper boats and paper like planes and like it was just a dumb idea I had. It was like Rugrats, but for like Chinese military.
I wouldn't use the word dumb to describe that. That's cool as
no,
fuck.
I like
it's
it.
Super unique.
It's fun.
So we've established that you're a writer, and you read. So in your opinion, written things are impactful. It's not a stretch
absolutely.
To say that you feel that way.
Yeah,
absolutely. Yeah, absolutely.
Have you ever read anybody's reviews of your own work and like felt any strong opinion either way? Like, oh, fuck yeah, I just got a review or...
Yeah.
Like, when I see things like that people say it's like derivative, I'm just like, whatever, I don't care. And when I see people that say it's great, I'm just happy.
Like, it's nice. Like it's an
awesome. Yeah. Yeah, it's like, I'm glad that you enjoyed it. But when people say it sucks, I don't really try to let it bother me.
Good.
Because like I'm if it didn't make you happy, then I clearly didn't make music for you. So
exactly.
Like
that's quotable for damn sure. So what you're saying is you don't read your rate your music reviews.
Rate my music reviews?
Rate your music, the website.
Oh, no, I mean, like, people can hate my music as much as they want, or they can love it as much as they want. It just doesn't, I don't really care either way. But, like, when I, if I ever happen to, like, just accidentally check my stuff just because I want to see, like, is it still getting traction or something like that?
Yeah.
I might see that there's some comments, and then I'll be like, all right, like, cool. Like, I'm glad people are still engaging with it.
Yeah. Well,
but
you know,
like,
it helps that you came
if
back.
someone hates it, I'm like, yeah, hate it as much as you want. Tell everyone how much you hate it, because maybe you might tell someone that you hate it so much, and then they have to go look it up, and then they're like, I don't think it's that bad.
It will stoke the flame of their interest, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, like, there is such thing as people being into things ironically, and then they actually get into them, like, actually. Or, like, they hate it so much, but it's because it's, like, growing on them like an earworm. So there's always that approach.
So many things start as, like, a joke and then turn into a serious thing.
I'm always the fan of, like, I've always been the fan of, like, some of my friends that have gotten way bigger than me in the music world. Mm-hmm. They're just like, any press is good press.
Right.
I mean, yeah, pretty much.
So it's just like, all right, yeah, if you're getting hated on, like, more people are going to hear about it, because it's actually haters that talk more about you than people that like you.
You know, it's anything that invokes a strong emotion in somebody and makes them sort of, like, continue to fixate on it. It creates an energy. Do you know what I mean? And that energy can always be galvanized in a way, no matter if it's negative or positive. Just energy is energy at the end of the day.
Yeah, so if you, like, I feel like the only bad art in the world that can even exist is the type of art that people, like, view and take in, and then they're like, it made me feel nothing. Like, that's the worst review you could ever get.
Indifference, right?
Yeah.
Yeah,
I love,
like, indifference, like, if you love it or hate it, that means the art did something right. But if you're just like, that was something, that's bad art.
I love having that conversation with our guests, asking if they believe in objectively good or bad art. And it's
yeah, no.
I think that's a really wise answer.
I think that there is no good or bad art, but you can develop a taste. And you can say, for me, this is not good. And for me, this is good. And that's just my taste speaking, but it's not passing a complete judgment on the art itself. It's almost just telling you where I stand, where my pike is in the river. And this is where it's at. And this flows with me. And this
my
flows
pike in the river. I like that.
Well, you
that.
Know what I mean? So it's like, you can say there's no bad art, and there's no good art, but
I've never heard that, but I love that.
You could develop your taste, right? And then it's just like I was saying about being a cultural critic or whatever. You get, but this, it says something about you when you, what you determine to be not good and what you determine to be good. And that's more of a.
I want to comment on Celadon Dream saying, is electro swing objectively bad? I want to say that nothing is objectively bad unless it comes from a place of hatred. But, like, as far as art goes, like, nothing is ever objectively bad.
Mm, yeah, exactly.
I will gently disagree with your take on electro swing not being objectively bad, but that's okay. Overall, I generally agree with the thought that you're correct. Art that doesn't provoke any sort of response would be bad, I guess, right?
Yeah, that's what I'm basically trying to say. Thank you for putting it in, like, a very quick sentence. But
of course.
Like, if art doesn't make you feel something, then it is probably not that great.
So electro swing, like, makes me feel anger, so I guess it's good art.
It's making you feel something, and that's the point of art. It makes you question yourself and makes you question your feelings. So, like you can meet people that hate hip-hop, and it's just like, this angers me. And it's like, but that's just you, man.
That's crazy. Like,
yeah.
I can't believe there's anybody left that doesn't like any kind of, doesn't like hip hop, like at least something from hip hop. That feels impossible to me at this point.
But there are just people that hate certain forms of music. You know?
But, like, hip hop is so just ubiquitous. It's everywhere. There's so many different versions.
It literally is probably the most popular type of music.
Popular music in the world.
Yeah.
Or in America, sorry. And that's kind of, you can't escape it. So, like, I can't imagine people. That's so strange to me that anybody in 2023 could be like, I don't like hip hop. Like, there's got to be something you like from it. It's not like it just started. It's
everywhere. You always say.
I just said hip hop for just because I was saying hip hop. But there could be people that be like, I hate jazz because they're just playing a bunch of notes. And it's like, well, sure, they are. Like, experimental jazz. I understand why people could not like it. But, like, there's nothing inherently wrong with it. So it's like, you can hate whatever you want to hate. That doesn't make you, like, a bad person. So it's like, there's something for everybody, I feel.
I do agree. And Chris has a saying that he often uses. He says, like,
a bad person if you don't like
what's the artist, the Patty something? I'm
Patty Smith.
Like I said, I have, like, a culture void. Patty Smith. He says you can find your Patty Smith in every genre. Like, you're going to find something that you'll like about anything.
there's somebody out there that's approaching right your that's approaching a genre that you're ignoring with like truth and sincerity and creativity, and is an interesting person and is channeling their interesting personness through the medium that they're in. And that exists in all the genres. You just have to look. It's just whether you want to take the time to look for it or not.
Yeah, you're not wrong. I don't think I'll ever find any electro swing that I like, but if I put enough time and energy into it, I might.
Yeah, you don't have to. Life's short. You know what I mean?
Life is indeed. Before we get into the question, well, no, actually, we've got a question that's been pinned for a minute. Pacific Plaza, good friend of the show, great at asking questions, wants to know, what type of cigarette are you smoking on?
Marlboro Black.
Damn, that's what I used to smoke before I quit.
Yeah, Marlboro Black.
Cheap and does the trick.
Yeah, it's just a Marlboro Red, but it's like 30 cents cheaper.
Yeah. It's like just, it tastes that much more like dirt.
I'm just a penny pincher.
Well, they've gotten so expensive ever since I quit. Well, before Skelly starts asking the good questions, I just want to say it has just come into my mind. I had a hot take several episodes ago about artists deleting their work from the internet.
Oh, yeah, I remember.
And it has just come into my mind that there was a song of yours, George, that was deleted that was like one of the best fucking songs I ever heard, and it just disappeared from SoundCloud one day. And I want to look up what it was called, but if I... The stream is being weird. When I pull up iTunes, it like shits out and all of our window captures disappear. It is a song called Skylines, except it's dollar signs for the S's. And that shit disappeared from SoundCloud, and I'm still mad about it.
Yeah, I don't even have that anymore.
Oh, no.
Well,
so I made that song, and I released it on my birthday, like...
I remember that.
Many, many years ago. But, like, what happened was, like, my computer exploded, like, pretty much, and I couldn't get access to the hard drive on the computer. Like, it's just, like, a dead piece of technology. So it's, like, I don't know where that, like, I'm never going to be able to get back to that song. But I actually really like Skylines, too.
Well, I'm going to tell you, like, a little evil little tidbit, and that's that I actually ripped the audio. And
I still have
it in, like...
Wow. What's...
like 128K or some shit, and I banged that song.
Could you send that to me just so I could like even have
it? If you guys haven't heard Skylines,
I'd like to hear this song as well.
I mean, it's 128K, so it's never gonna get played at Terminally Chill, but it fucks. It's one of my favorite things.
Yeah, I want to hear the song.
I like the track that I made, but it was just like, yeah, my computer died and I couldn't get the data off of it. So I lost there. I had so many songs on the chopping block too that I was just like, yeah, this could be released at one point. And it's
I hate when that happens.
Yeah.
Save everybody.
Skelly,
that.
I really hope that you have kept the songs that you decided not to release on your upcoming album. You could use that shit for your Patreon, bro.
No,
or just some sort of rework in the
Sometimes
future.
I use them for, like, if I get asked to do compilation work, you know.
There you go. Yeah, or, like, say somebody wants a B-side, and you're like, okay, well, here you go. Here's a track that didn't quite make the cut, you know.
Yeah, I've reworked this new album so many times.
Well, I'm excited that it's coming out. I'm going to just test
our... Fifth draft of it, maybe.
You said you weren't going to redo it again.
Yeah, I'm done it now. I'm not redoing it again now. That's enough.
Well, I'm gonna just make sure our audio sounds good if you want to hit Quartz with some actual questions.
No, these are all good questions, but yeah, I'd like to get started with some questions.
Yeah, go ahead and give us some questions as well, please, Chad.
First of all, I really want to know, when did you start making music? And what form of music did you start doing first?
Oh, okay. So I started music when I was 14.
You're 14, okay.
Yeah, like I wanted a guitar forever. My parents never bought me one until I was.
I had the same situation with that too. My parents never wanted to buy me a guitar.
Yeah, but my first genre was metal, so I played
nice.
Metal and yeah, I played metal from like 14 until I was like 27. But
So metal, listening to metal is what made you start thinking, I want to make music. I want to channel. This is how I want to channel myself through this kind of art.
It was System of a Down that made me want to play guitar.
Interesting. Okay.
Awesome.
Yeah, that's a big inspiration at 14, especially. It's not a bad one to have as your big inspiration that, like, I want to do this too. It's pretty good.
Yeah, it was System of a Down. And it was, like, my first song I learned on guitar ever was Aerial.
Really?
Aww. Yeah. And this was like 2003. So.
Have you ever considered...
2004, because I was 14. 2004.
Have you ever considered using guitar in King Quartz?
I do.
Yeah, I was about to say, I'm pretty sure I've heard guitar on a few of these songs.
Maybe I've just not heard.
Well, you can't really always tell what's a sample and what's not, though. That's the thing. And that's the nice thing about your music in general, is that it's difficult to always tell. It's very nicely blended into a way that makes it an interesting sort of soup of some sorts. Everything's kind of swirling around.
Yeah, also, like, just this is jumping ahead a lot, like, from my youth to a certain thing. But, like, I did, like, go to a school after I graduated high school, where I went to school for audio engineering and mixing and mastering.
Oh, fuck
yeah. Oh, really? You did?
So, nice.
Yeah. So, I took kind of some of that knowledge, and I didn't fully graduate, like, just because of money problems, family issues, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
But, like, I learned a lot of shit, and then, like, I just took my passion of, like, if I'm going to sample and then add, like, actually recorded things on top of it, mm-hmm. I don't want people to know that I'm doing that. Like, I want to take my mixing knowledge and know how to, like, blend the samples and the things I'm adding and not let them be able to figure that out. Like, what part is the sample? What part is the actual instrument? Yeah.
I like
you. I think that you're one of the best artists at doing that, actually, in my opinion. Like, I think everything is, in my opinion, I think that you really do an excellent job at making those textures kind of really blend and mix in a way where things are constantly changing just a little bit to the point you can't really
pin your finger down
on what's going on. And I've always really appreciated that about your productions. It's very interesting. Well, so then let me go back a second here. So you started by learning metal music. Any other influences aside from System of a Down? Were there any other guys that came into play for you that were inspiring?
Well, like, System of a Down made me want to learn guitar, right?
Yeah.
And then from there, this is, like, right before then, before I, like, was able to convince my parents to buy me a guitar.
Uh-huh.
That was the age of LimeWire. Were you guys...
Oh, yeah.
Yep. Uh-huh. Yep.
You were around for LimeWire?
Yeah, I'm old. Okay. I was around for LimeWire.
Okay. So, like one day I was just being a spooky little goth, like, 10-year-old. I just typed in, like, death in LimeWire.
Death.
And the band Death shows up.
Yeah, that's great.
And I get like Cannibal Corpse, and I get, like, Cryptopsy.
Oh, man. Oh, so you get into all the death metal.
Yeah, so I was just like, whoa, these motherfuckers sound so weird, I want to learn how to play that. So, like, that was, like, my thing, was just, like, I want to play heavy music that sounds just crazy.
Mm-hmm.
Because, like, before that, like, my parents, like, raised me on Black Sabbath and Led Zeppelin and, like,
oh, wow.
Nice,
cool.
The roots.
That's cool, like, too. That's not, like, bad to have a, like, background on that as well.
Yeah, it's, like, that's not bad, but it's, like, it didn't ever interest my ears as, like, a little kid listening to it.
Of course. Well, it wasn't exactly yours. It was your parents. I mean, we never exactly want the same thing our parents had.
Yeah.
I'm, like, envious of people that do.
I think the... like, the best thing my parents ever showed me was King Crimson.
We got some big King Crimson
fans in chat right now.
Because, like, King Crimson, like, and the Court of the Crimson King, like, that album will stand the test of time, in my opinion.
It has already, yeah.
Yeah, but it was just, like, it still necessarily wasn't, like, what I wanted to play, you know? Mm-hmm. It wasn't until I heard death metal that I was like, I need a guitar right now.
I love that. I love it. It's such a fun thing when something really clicks with us and it makes us be like, ah, yeah. And gives us, like, this sort of, like, unknown direction that we need to start heading in. So, okay. So now you're playing death metal. At what point do you start thinking about incorporating electronic elements to what you're making?
It was pretty much the same time because, like,
okay.
My parents bought me a guitar, and then they bought me, like, the cheapest, like, Kmart. Kmart still exists?
Like, in some places.
I guess, like, you know, just the cheapest keyboard you could get, uh-huh. You know? And I started learning piano and taught myself. And I taught myself guitar, too.
Yeah.
And then, like, once my parents saw that I was really into it, they put me into a music school. It was just like,
what made you want to start even using synthesizers though? I mean, there's not too much of
they
that
sound good, dude. At that,
was there
no
any
shit,
artist,
right? You can make any sound you want.
Was there, yeah, I mean, I felt the same way, but was there any artist you were listening to that was incorporating electronic noises into things that you thought was interesting as well?
I mean, just billions of them, but I just like the versatility of the idea that like, yeah, a guitar is always going to sound like a guitar. Like you can use amplifiers and pedals and different guitars to get different tones, but it's always going to sound like a guitar.
Yeah.
But like with a synthesizer, you can really like explore, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. 100%. But was there a particular synth-based artist that you really liked that really showed you, oh, wow, you can make so many different things? Like, you know what I mean? Was there an artist that you were kind of like, oh, this is interesting, that was synthesizer-based kind of?
I think it was like the goofy-ass sounds of like Yellow Magic Orchestra.
Oh, that's interesting. Yeah.
That's cool.
Also, like I believe Sun Ra used some synthesizers. And if they didn't, then I don't know how they made those sounds. and then Parliament.
Okay. Yeah. Interesting. These are good choices.
So we got a couple questions in chat. Once you finish your thought.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I'm sorry for interrupting.
No, you're
good. I thought your thought was over. I apologize.
No, I'm good.
But now that I've sufficiently interrupted,
did you listen to like Aphex Twin or anything like that? Was that ever anything that hit you?
I love Aphex Twin. Xtel I'll put on Xtel all day. Like, I'll put
Hell
on a 10
yeah.
hour loop of that.
All right. So
great choice.
And if you want to do one of the questions from the chat, that's fine.
Yeah. Celadon Dream Suite has some good ones. Let me get Celadon Dream Suite's two questions out of the way and I'll yield my time. First question, they want to know what your sample finding and selection process looks like.
Oh, like how I find samples?
Yeah. Or select them, you know. It's a good question.
Oh, well. How I find them is like, I love going to record stores. Thankfully I'm in Detroit, and then I was a touring musician in all my 20s. So like when we would be playing any of these, I could go like that's one thing I would always ask the people that like booked us is like, is there a cool record store that I can go to?
Nice.
Or a thrift store, because you can find a lot of vinyls at thrift stores.
Yeah,
that is true.
Like people just drop them off as it, like they don't even care, and you can just find some bangers in there for like 50 cents. And then also like just knowing how to type in YouTube, like let's say you just have a vibe in your head and it's just like Japanese funky 70s, and then just like try to find that rabbit hole, like, or just like, you know, like I want to do some JIT music, so let's look up some JIT shit. And just type in like JIT 92. And it's just like.
Oh, I heard gent. What is.
No, JIT.
JIT.
It's a Detroit style of dance, but it's got like this really cool house vibe.
JIT. So like Detroit house or Detroit techno?
No, it's like JIT.
I'm going to have JIT. To look into this. I'm a Philistine. Chris, have you ever heard of JIT?
No, but I feel like this is, it feels very Detroit to me. Detroit gets very, very down with their different styles of techno and house.
Chicago and Detroit, I feel like
have
it on lock.
That's the fucking places for that sort of stuff. Yeah, that's awesome.
Yeah.
I'm not familiar either.
Hey,
I will be now.
Laurel knows JIT.
The
crowns of Laurel.
Nice.
Second question that Celadon Dream Suite had really quickly was another good one. And they wanted to know, you mentioned King Crimson, right? That album, how meaningful it was. They wanted to know if that's where the name King Quartz comes from.
Okay. So name origin of King Quartz is actually super silly. So like I was homeless for a second, and then I moved in with a bunch of my brothers that became Black Toad, which is like Young Soldier.
Hell yeah, Black Toad.
BZ, ANT, Kamar, rest in peace. Five, rest in peace. Kev, Freeway, rest in peace. But like, it was just me and a bunch of people that like were hanging out, and we worked for this one studio, and they gave us this whole like big ass rack of like all this audio equipment.
Nice.
And so we had like a little quartz crystal because like we're spiritual people. And then like these two tiny shoes that I'm pretty sure were made for like a Mr. Potato Head or something, but they were like band style shoes. And we just put the quartz on top of the shoes. And then from like a Chambord bottle. Do you guys know what Chambord is?
Yeah. Liqueur. Yeah, it comes like those.
Yeah, it has the little crown thing,
The
crown top.
Mm-hmm.
So we just put the crown top on top of the quartz, and we just called that little like that little figure on top of our soundboard King Quartz.
That's adorable.
And so I was just like, that's my name now. It's like I'm just that little dude that sits on top of a soundboard. And so it started off as a joke, but then my name started like, you know, people listen to my music. I don't think that some people have listened to my music, but like I was just like, I guess that's my name now.
I always thought that was a sick fucking name. So hearing that story is quite insightful.
But it was just totally random. Like there wasn't a lot of thought. It was just like we had this little dude sitting right there, and I was just like, I'm just gonna release that as my name. Like I'm just gonna be that little dude that sits there.
Hell yeah. All right, I see my time.
Okay, so I got a few more questions now that you said a few other things recently. So, but first things first, when did you start, when did you get into vaporwave?
I didn't really get into vaporwave. I actually just fell into it. Because, like,
did you fall into it?
Like, while I was doing metal, me and Black Toad were doing hip-hop. And I just because of like my black metal background, the way I make beats, I like to make like really cloudy, ethereal sounding shit with just like heavy ass fucking 808.
Yeah.
Hell
and
yeah.
So we started, and so we just like started releasing stuff on SoundCloud, and people started like calling us Vaporwave.
Interesting.
Unreal.
And then you're like,
had you heard Vaporwave at all prior to that?
No.
Interesting. Wow. So you got sort of pulled into it. You were just moving in that direction and got kind of absorbed in. That's interesting.
Yeah, no, I had no idea about it. And then, like, I, like, ended up falling in love with it because I found out, like, that there was a community to it. And I was like, oh, this shit looks fucking cool. So I'll vibe with this. Like, I'll be Vaporwave.
It's hell funny because of how, like, how elastic it is and how much room there is for experimentation, you know?
Yeah, and then, like, I ended up, like, in the punk scene, I met people that, like, knew, like, it. I started learning that, like, a lot of these, like, OG Vaporwave artists, like, we all know each other on accident because we're at the same shows because we're all ex, like, metal or punk musicians.
That's so cool, dude.
Yeah, I mean, I also have, like, a background in, like, hardcore music scene prior to, like, all the, you know, Vaporwave and such.
Yeah. Yeah, it's just like there's a real like tie in there, like with like metal, punk, black metal, death metal, and then like newer forms of electronic music like synthwave, future funk, vaporwave, whatever. But like it's never surprising to find out. It's like, oh yeah, you used to listen to Dark Throne.
She said you were a touring musician.
That's exactly where I was gonna go. Thank you. I want to hear all about it.
Yeah, that's interesting.
Yeah, I was in three different bands. One was called Axe Ripper, and that was more like hardcore thrash death metal blend. There was one that I created, which was called Crumble, which was just basically like crusty punk black metal.
Yes.
And then Euphoria, where we were like cyberpunk like black metal.
Oh wow!
Or cyberpunk thrash metal. But like, yeah, I got to tour Europe. Couple times.
Oh wow, amazing.
I didn't know you guys went to Europe.
Yeah, Euphoria went to Europe.
Nice.
And then like all the other bands that I was in, I don't know, I probably toured the United States like 14 times amongst those three.
Unreal.
Like metal bands.
That's
like why I kind of missed the mark of Vaporwave too, like right when it was exploding, like when artists that like were just SoundCloud people were starting to get shows. I was busy touring in metal.
Like you were busy.
I wasn't so focused on doing Vaporwave and future funk stuff. It was just like I need to play, like, I would tour like 8 months out of the year sometimes.
Oh, unbelievable. Wow. That's crazy. And,
yeah, but it was just like, I'm not involved in the scene, and that's like how I kind of disappeared for a while.
Ah.
You know?
We have had a couple people on the show that were touring musicians, but admittedly, most of our guests have not. So it's really cool to hear that you went to Europe.
Just, I wasn't doing like vaporwave or electronic music, you know?
Do you miss touring? Or not?
Yeah, absolutely. Like, I mean, like, I'm playing a show in St. Louis on April 7th.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, that's April a nice 7th. Out-of-state thing.
And that's for somebody that's in chat right now, I believe.
Yeah, Ronnie boy.
Ronnie, Vaporspace, St. Louis. That's going to be at Platypus, I presume, or Pop's Blue Moon?
Yep, it's at Platypus.
Platypus. We were there. Great venue.
Yeah.
You want to run that date by us one more time? I think you said April 7th?
April 7th.
April 7th. Be there.
St. Louis, Missouri at Platypus.
Let's do it.
So, I just want to ask you.
With Sound Market and OIP.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
It's great, fellas.
Let me ask you for a second, because since you come from this metal background and you moved into this sort of experimental music background, like, what is your process like for writing music? Where do you start usually when you're producing something?
Oh, I mean, that's a tough question, bud.
Yeah, it's a good one, though.
So sorry to ask, but just because you have such an interesting metal background, I'm like, well, when you get down in front of your digital audio workstation, you're like, where does it start?
I think it starts with, like, for me personally, I see, like, visuals in my head, like, how I want this song to...
Yeah,
how I
that's
want
cool.
the song to, like
Love
feel.
It. Love it, yeah.
And, like, when I was, like, a little kid, like, I had problems in school, and I was diagnosed with synesthesia. So I think that, like, affects my writing process.
Mm-hmm.
Because, like, I'm not the best at eye contact and stuff. But, and like sometimes I just fucking zone out, like, so hard. Yeah. But, like, I like to, if I'm trying to write a song, I try to write it in a certain color. Or, like, shades of colors. Like, I basically, like, a song needs to be, like, a color palette. Not only is, like, the rhythm important, but the color palette of the song is important.
Interesting.
And I guess, like, that's how I just kind of approach is, like, I kind of, like, hear a song, like, or a melody, and it's like, oh, it sounds like this color. So I want to, like, put rhythm to it, and I work from there. But I guess the best answer then, to make it short, sorry I'm taking so long.
No,
I'm loving this.
It's a big question, I realize, you know.
But it's just like I write melody first, rhythm second.
Oh, but so like, you write the melody first. Well, I've talked to a lot of people who start with the drums.
Like
first.
A hook? Or like the
No. Like a vibe. Like
I got you.
Like what's gonna be the spine of the song.
I got
and,
you.
Yeah. And then and then you work from there. Like you build
melody
like,
is one of my favorite elements in music. So I love to hear that.
Yeah. And like rhythmically I also write with percussion in mind. So it's like, because you don't want the rhythm just to be like wild and out of control. Like the rhythm needs to hit on certain marks.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like when you're writing, you could be like, dun, 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 yeah. dun, dun, dun. Like, mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. like you can add heaviness to something, or you could be like, dun, 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 dun,
dun. Love it.
Like,
love this.
So it's like you want to write like around color, and then like with your melody, you also want to keep in mind how the percussion is going to interact with it. And
do
I guess
you use those writing techniques for metal music as well?
Of course, yeah. I just write every genre the same. Like,
nice.
I have, like, my writing style. The only thing that changes the genre, really, is the tone.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Because,
I gotcha.
Like, I can take a vaporwave song and make a death metal any day.
That's right. Like, it's a statement. Yeah, wow.
That would be wild to hear.
Yeah, but, like, all you'd have to do is just change the instruments playing those tones. And, like... maybe change the percussion a little bit, because percussion is what almost dictates a genre, you know.
You're absolutely right.
It's a very interesting observation.
He's absolutely right. I mean, we have like juke and footwork with the triplets. We have trap with the hi-hat rolls. We have house and techno with the four on the floor beat. He's absolutely right.
Not even just that too. It's also so weird. Just how the drums sound themselves. You know what I mean?
True.
The timbre of them and the way it's produced. It's definitely what you just said, the rhythms, but also just like the way that the drums hit and the way that they sound and the way that they're processed. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
We have another chat question that's been kind of hanging out for a second. I want to get out of the way really fast. Somebody, Afternoon Walk, wants to know, on the topic of metal music, how edgy do you like your death metal lyrics to be?
It depends on what you define by as edgy, but like, I love the cheesy fucking like Cannibal Corpse stuff where it's just like,
oh dude,
the fact that they're like a part of the lyrics, and I hope this person knows what song I'm saying. It's four words in the song. That's it, and they're right next to each other. Hammer smashed scrotum sack.
Dude, whenever I'm like, having a bad day, I just go read a bunch of Cannibal Corpse song titles.
That's some death metal lyrics. But also like I feel like if death metal is taken seriously, like you're doing it wrong.
Hammer smash like, scrotum sack.
Yeah, it's like how can you be serious? So it's like you need to approach death metal as like it's not even edgy, it's just like silly.
It's like yeah.
it's just finding the best way to put the most disgusting things next to each other.
Oh dude, Cannibal Corpse is definitely quite good at that.
Yeah, I mean like I love like if you want to like go edgy, if you're like talking like you're trying to try too hard, I would say, and I love this band to death, but like they're trying so hard and it breaks that barrier of where like they're not being edgy anymore, they're just being like they're self-aware. It would be Demulish.
Okay.
I can spell it in the chat.
Yeah, probably would be helpful to do that.
I love this band so much. And they put out like one album in like 94. But
Like a lich. Like an undead like wizard or whatever a lich is.
Yeah, but like their song titles are just so silly and their lyrics make no sense. And their vocals are just like, he sounds like a weird toad that's like choking on a football.
Oh, he has like the Cookie Monster lyric thing or vocals going on.
Yeah, but they have like no musical theory. Like it's musical theory, they're just like, can I just break the rule? Like, let's play in diminished augmented fifths for the entire song. And it's just like, why are you doing this? And they're like, I don't know, but I made it sound heavy as fuck, didn't I?
Heavy as fuck.
Like, yeah, you did.
I love that.
Can you tell us some of your favorite songs by Demulich? I need to hear some of these song titles.
Okay, let me pull them up because you can't expect my brain to know these.
I know, right?
I think that's very, you know, that's a very interesting thing about a lot of genres, particularly something like death metal, which is just a place where you can go and like, get this catharsis and release all these like weird, almost like gross juvenile thoughts out and just like put it out there and have a fun way to enjoy it and to explore that part of your brain. You know what I mean? It's like music in general is just a great, great place for that kind of catharsis of like just modern day-to-day living and just be like, I'm going to be in this space for a little bit right now. I'm going to like put it all out, do it in a really interesting way.
That's what I loved about playing like vaporwave and black metal. Like both of those styles of genres, while though they're like completely different, they allow you to explore your expressionism in any way you want.
They're super escapist too.
Yeah, for sure.
Like they're super surreal or like kind of tongue in cheek.
Yeah. It's like you're just allowed to do whatever you fucking want. But here's my favorite Demulish song to answer your question. The planet that once used to absorb flesh in order to achieve divinity and immortality suffocated to the flesh that it desired. Ellipsis.
Love it.
Damn.
And then the song that comes after that is just cry.
Cry.
Love it. So when you're making vaporwave music, obviously, you know, what are you kind of tapping into from yourself when you do that? Like, what is the appeal? Like, why vaporwave?
I think to me, like, the reason I even fell into that thing is because I am also just a product of the 90s. Like, I'm not that young.
Yeah.
So like I grew up seeing a lot of this shit, and so I just like fucking with it.
Yeah, it is fun. Very it cool. is fun to sort of just take these. It's really fun.
I'm sorry that wasn't more introspective, but
no, that was very good.
Nostalgia is very powerful.
I just like fucking with it.
That was great. Yeah. It's really
like I want to fuck up a Hey Arnold sample. I want to chop and screw Hey Arnold.
Oh
and
yeah.
And that's kind of a fun thing
we
to do.
We need some more of that.
You're just like repurposing these memories you had as a child. You're like, you know what? I just sort of absorbed them. Now I'm in control of that. You know what I mean?
Yes.
Now I can take the media that was like kind of always, you know, kind of bombarded upon me as a child, like these silly commercials for soap, and I can like now like I can rewire them.
About to recontextualize some shit.
Yeah, that was always fun for me. When I used to make music videos for Skeleton Lipstick at the beginning, I had the one music video for the song 2040 AD, and it was taking the commercials, but like just only taking the reaction shots of the people in the commercials and what they thought of the product, but never showing the product itself. See, this compilation of these like silly expressions, this hyper reality of like oh my god, amazing!
Right,
but then you
that
don't show the product
for sure.
So all you get is like the people being amazed by something and they overacting, and that's kind of so funny and cartoonish. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
You take
it
the actual
indeed.
Product away. You know, it's interesting.
Pacific Plaza has a really good question relating to touring, and this is apropos coming from him as somebody who's worked with a lot of touring musicians. And has toured himself. He wants to know if you have a favorite gas station, corner store, or truck stop that you ever experienced on tour, and he wants to know what snacks you got there. Great fucking question.
It was in Germany.
Okay.
Right outside of Berlin. I don't remember the name of the place, because I'll be honest, we had drank so much rum in the morning. And no, it was Cuban rum. You can't get Cuban rum in the United States.
Well, yeah, that's not surprising.
You know? So, like, they had Cuban rum in Germany, and I was on tour. It was, like, me and Euphoria, so it's, like, a bunch of Detroit boys. But we were also sharing the tour bus with Game Over, who are from Italy.
Very cool. Amazing band.
Yeah, amazing band. They're still touring. They still play and make albums. Like, amazing people. But, so we were on tour together. Like, every night we were playing together.
Wild.
But, like, it was just some random fucking truck stop in Germany. And I got schnitzel and goulash. And I remember I ordered both because I was just so hungry. I was just like, I want all the heartiest things.
Yeah.
And the person just looked at me and, like, in this crazy, like, the thickest German accent. I can't repeat it. But she was just like, schnitzel and goulash? and... Like she was offended. Like, how dare you order that? But then I ate both of them, and just they were
hell
appalled.
Yeah.
They were just they were appalled, appalled that like Americans could eat like this.
Well, boys, I'm gonna grab another drink. I'll be right back.
The Italians that I were with, the band Game Over, like they loved it. They just loved that I ordered that. They were just cracking up.
I had no idea it was such a strange thing to do that, to order the two things. Wow.
Yeah, I thought I
wouldn't have even
thing. I was just like, I'm hungry.
Oh wow. So currently you're not are you doing anything metal related these days, or are you mostly focusing on other things?
There is one thing that might be happening, but I can't speak on it right now.
Understood.
But no, mostly I'm just focused on moving well with my mixology career as being like a cocktail curator.
Yes.
But then also doing my King Quartz stuff, trying to just bring that back. I really want to get back to just focusing on electronic music. And I'm also doing a dark ambient album.
Oh,
so, bro, I will be so over the moon when those things drop.
Yeah, thank you.
So tell us a little bit more about Well, finish that thought first, and then I want to hear about the mixology.
Oh, yeah. But my dark ambient name is And the Ocean Stream Eternal. So I'm working on a new
And the Ocean Stream Eternal. Nice. Have you dropped anything on your Bandcamp or anything yet?
My first album was released in, like, 2006.
Oh, okay.
You should drop a link in chat.
And That's under Dungeon Thief Records. Cool. He's a cool bud of mine. I've known him since 2006, but he's a cool dude.
That's way back.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, dude. I was 16 when I got signed to a record label. That was my senior project in high school.
That's unreal. Crazy.
What was that like? How did that feel?
I don't know. I didn't really think too much of it. It was like everyone, like, for our senior project, we had to either write a song or like a couple songs. And then I just fucked around, got signed to a record label, and dropped an album.
Oh, Vaporspace found the link. Thanks, bud. Natural, yeah. How do you pronounce that? Obeisance?
Yeah.
Good stuff.
Nocturnal.
My bad. I can't read, I promise.
Also, keep in mind, this was like, I recorded it when I was like 15, and I wasn't that good at it. So. But I think
but it's valuable history.
I knew how to make like an atmosphere, but I wasn't that great at playing instruments. Yeah.
What's some music that inspires you that is not exactly metal related or something we might not expect?
Great.
Oh, dude.
Question.
And anything inspires me. Like, mm-hmm. Like I get inspired by like how like birds sound.
I love that.
Like I get inspired by the weirdest shit, man. Like, I could listen to that any genre.
Is there a particular one that you keep coming back to that's interesting to you, that you just, not necessarily something we might expect, but you always kind of, maybe you come back to it every once in a while, because you're like, you know what, that album or that artist, there's something there that I keep kind of returning to once in a while.
Okay, yeah, let me pull them up. Wait, I can't. My phone is my camera. No, I think the Hylum, like this. Their albums like Hylum? Do a lot for me. I love this.
Check that out.
I love this artist. This
Wardrobe.
Artist.
Okay, I'm looking these up right now.
Yeah, I'd like to know a lot about what they. Okay, so that last one sounds.
Whoa,
like
what is it? What? Yeah.
What kind of music
Wait,
are these?
I spelled it wrong. It's
Power Hylum. Daughter,
oh,
yeah.
Oh, I'm familiar with Hylum.
Yeah, it's just
they
like,
do like a they're like a dark ambient sort of soundscape
also,
thing, right?
Also, Fuerz Darajita, I fucking love them. There's that.
Damn.
You should put in if you're searching something up for Fuerz Darajita, just do like Fuerz Darajita Los Cambios.
Fuerza.
Tasty track.
Yeah.
I'm familiar with
tasty track.
I don't know all these, but I'm definitely very familiar with Hylum.
My man's
put really epic.
Come on. Never heard of any of these guys.
Hylum is really epic. I'm a big fan of them actually. But I gotta look up some of these other ones. I'm not familiar with all these other guys.
Is a lot of this like dark ambient type of music?
In the Hylum's also got a lot of like weird chanting and stuff in it, like interesting field recordings.
Fuerz Darajita is like gangster ass South American music.
Oh, Videodrome rating with a party of 23. Shout out Videodrome TV. Let me ask you. I got an off the wall one for you. I want to know how you feel. I want to know how important album artwork is to you, George. What's up, guys? Welcome to the show. We want to know what King Quartz thinks about album artwork. How important is it?
It's pretty important, I think. Like, I mean, like, you want to catch the eye, right?
Yeah.
Like, you want people to give a fuck when they see it.
It's kind of wild how that works, huh? Do you remember the days when you would pick an album up at the record store and go, well, this cover looks good. I guess I'll give it a spin.
Well, that's how I found myself into like metal and stuff, because it was just like, these albums look spooky. Like,
nice.
So it was like, yeah, it was like the album art is what drew me into it. It was like looking at it and being like, oh, this looks crazy as shit. Mm-hmm. I want to buy it. Like, very I want to cool. listen to whatever the fuck this is.
What are some of your favorite examples of good album artwork?
The one that got me into into technical death metal, which I'm so happy about because that made me learn guitar even better, was Nile, Annihilation of the Wicked.
Oh, Nile!
Because
great.
It, yeah, but that album art is just so perfect. It looks classy. It's not over. It doesn't look like a death metal album.
I'm about to
it
look this shit up too.
Really fucking cool.
My rig is not powerful enough for me to look that up while we're broadcasting. You said Annihilation of the
Kenny
Wicked.
Kenny Loggins rules. I do believe. I do agree. I'm just responding to the chat.
Yeah, absolutely true. That's facts.
For sure.
That's some turn up music right there. Annihilation of the Wicked. Oh, that is some pretty cool. Okay.
I think that this is you being 15, right? You know?
Mm-hmm. And you're just in a record store.
No, you're just in a record store and you see that record and you're just all right, this is probably dope as hell.
Right. Shit is about to slay. Somebody is we got some real Kenny Loggins fans in chat. I love that.
As we should.
I would like to hear an example of what you think is some really bad album artwork.
Ooh, bad album artwork?
Yes.
Man, I wish I could.
I like how you're looking around. You about to whip out one of your albums or something?
No,
Come on.
I have such good things, but I can't remember their names.
Oh, it'll come to you.
Okay. So, it's Tubes.
Oh, Tubes.
The band Tubes.
Yeah, I'm familiar with Tubes. Which album?
The one that has just the PVC pipe as a. As an album cover, it's just a PVC pipe.
I think that's the completion of the completion backward principle or something like that.
It's just
the T-shaped tube on it, right?
Yeah,
that's the completion backward principle, I think.
The band is called Wild. Tubes.
It's great. I love Tubes. I think
I'm such a plebeian.
Super fun.
I've never
the album kind of slaps in the weirdest ways, but it does. A shitty album cover.
Yeah, it's just like the T-shaped PVC pipe on it as the cover.
It's how am I supposed to be interested?
The completion backward principle.
Yeah, there's a song on there. It's a Sushi Girl that I like a lot.
I know. Those lyrics are so.
Oh, that shit ain't that bad. It's got a little shadow beneath it and everything. Come on,
dude. No, come on. No, that album cover sucks.
He goes, that album cover sucks. All right.
I only listened to it because I was like, this looks like such fucking trash.
How funny. So what did you say earlier about any press is good press? That album cover sucks so much ass you had to listen to it.
I guess it. All right.
That means it's good. That means it's good art, buddy.
I don't know.
Oh man. So how do you go about finding new music, no matter what it is, and how often do you do it?
I don't find new music a lot, to be honest. A lot of it just comes from my friends, people.
I love that.
Because I don't really hang out with a lot of musicians or anything. Like, I'm not really in that circle. I don't care to be. So a lot of my friends do completely different things that aren't art related at all. So I like to hear about what they're listening to and just see how people that live in different pathways in their life, kind of what they like to enjoy.
I like that.
And then I just kind of
you don't want to live in an echo chamber.
Yeah, but a lot of my friends, I hate what they listen to, but it's interesting to see, what they like, you know?
I feel that.
Yeah,
that's a good answer, man.
I don't try to hang out in an echo chamber at all. I don't believe in that shit. I think it's stupid and a waste of time. So I like to hang out with people that, do things that I don't do.
Yeah.
So,
that's,
we can
really
all...
smart.
Yeah, so it's better to have varying opinions than everyone just standing around being I agree.
Yeah. Completely.
It's literally been proven that diversity makes every group stronger.
Yeah.
And I'm not even trying to tout like a feel good statement. It's been proven. Like in business and workplaces, you know, just in anything. That's why I will always be a little scamp and disagree with you guys.
Yeah, we're not meant to agree on everything. I feel like that's like a wisdom that a lot of people seem to not consider sometimes. It's like, we can totally disagree with each other. That doesn't mean we need to get angry at each other, but we can think that like one thing you like sucks without hating each other.
Yeah, absolutely. It's so boring if everybody agrees with everything.
Yeah.
Yeah, thoroughly agree. I mean, it helps you perfect
agreeing
your
on things
product
for Melvins.
If you point out
for Melvins.
Like the Melvin, like the band?
Like the band?
Yeah, Melvins?
Like King Buzzo and all them, the Melvins?
King Buzzo.
Yeah, wow. That's what he's talking about.
Shout out an underrated act for us that you can think of right now.
There's too many.
Let's hear
please
them
don't
all
do this to me.
Okay, it's fine. That's fine.
Yeah, please what? Don't do that to me.
No worries.
I'll shout out Convulsus. That's Convulsus, a death metal band from Detroit.
Mm-hmm.
Some of my good homies. Mammon, some of my best homies. Also from Flint, Michigan. Solid black metal. I don't know. You broke my brain with that question.
It's okay. We'll come back to it.
These are good shout outs. We're good.
Yeah, we'll start with that.
Octane from Atlanta, Georgia.
Hell yeah.
Live from the City from Pittsburgh. Definitely check out Octane if you're into like hard ass trap.
Octane. Nice.
Yeah. Yeah. O C T V. And like it's spelled like Octane, but the A's are V.
Oh, if there's a V in it, I know it's some hard trap shit. It's probably like wave music or Witch House or something.
He used to work with me when he lived in Detroit. Like he was a part of Black Toad for a second. But nice. Then live from the City in Pittsburgh, like while I was living in Pittsburgh, he was super dope dude, fucking awesome guy. And his music pretty much, like it slaps really well too. But it's more like it's not like hard trap or anything. It's hip hop and a little bit of trap music mixed in with it. But like, it's not like crazy harsh shit, you know?
Right. Like, not like drill or anything.
It's like melodic.
I like it.
Like
I like
very
it.
Very melodic.
That's, you gave us a lot to go on, man. And
sorry.
Proper respect to you. No, that's nothing to apologize. You don't owe me no apology. Proper respect to you for shouting out local, like DIY and just, you know, experimental acts.
Yeah. Oh, and if you're into like Cybercrust, Lilac
Cyber
Web.
Cybercrust. I love how much of like punk rock influence a lot of your shit that you're involved in has. Cyberpunk.
Yeah, I love that.
Crust
shit.
Punk. I'll take it. Punk. I feel like punk rock makes everything better. Hot take.
I just love music where it's like well, not even music, but like if you're going to be an artist, I love art that doesn't give a fuck.
Yeah.
It's just like I just want to fucking do it. Like I don't care about your
nice
opinion. Here it is.
Nice. I really really like that. And punk rock is very much like a we're just going to get this shit done. And we're going to be
yeah,
loud and raw
gonna,
and fast.
And, we're gonna, and also, we're going to do it ourselves. We're going to develop our own little, you know, ecosystem for it. You know what I mean?
Very community-based.
Yeah.
So, what would you say is your most popular track that you ever made? And can you tell us the story behind creating it?
Oh, it's definitely Dancing. I mean, that has over, like, 1.3 million streams just on Spotify.
Shit out right now.
But I made that in like 20 minutes.
Oh yeah.
Isn't it funny how that works?
No, dude, it pisses me off because like the songs I've worked artists on and like I put my whole soul into are like they go nowhere.
Wait, what's one that you put your whole soul into?
Yeah, Dancing, Who I Am.
I want to know what's one of the songs you put your whole soul into.
Saddest Cigarette.
That's a great song.
I think I've been using that.
I love
for our
that
Insta
song.
Stories.
That's on the 2020 album that you were just talking about. That's a great song. That's the vocals in that and everything. That song's awesome, by the way. I'm a big fan of that one.
Thank you.
I'm a big fan of the one that you did with Fashionista Boyfriend is what he goes by now. He used to go by Gay Axis.
Oh, Gay Axis.
Yeah. Casey's been on our show. And that Casey. Song.
Yeah.
Wanderlust fucking goes.
Dude,
hard.
Casey has a beautiful voice and just also like a beautiful approach to melody. Like I love
He's
that
a beautiful
dude.
Person. Shout out Fashionista Boyfriend. And that song with that bass line. And the little effect, I can't remember what it's called off the top of my head, but when you just cut sound on beat, you know what
weird.
I'm talking about.
I was just gating it.
Yeah, there's a name for that on unlike CDJs and XDJs, but it's just escaping me. But that song fucking goes. If anyone in chat listens to anything, you need to listen to Wanderlust with King Quartz and Fashionista Boyfriend when he went by Gay Axis or Guy Axis.
Yeah.
That makes sense because Gaia. My bad.
Yep, it was Gaia and Axis put together.
Gaia Axis.
But yeah. Yep. But I love Casey. He was dope. And he still is dope. And I love Fashionista Boyfriend, so people should check that out.
I got
to
meet him when I played Terminally Chill NorCal in Sacramento. He is a
video chat with the lad.
He is a tiny, little, very fit man, and he's very quiet. He showed up at our show in a little mask, and I didn't notice him until he finally came up to me and was like, here's a Fashionista Boyfriend. He did a release called AM Affairs. I believe that was him. I'm going to be really embarrassed if it's not, but I'm like 99% sure he also was AM Affairs, and he gave me a tape because he knew I liked it. Wonderful person.
I still don't have my first actual King Quartz album, though.
What?
Like and like this is just I'm doing a tangent from talking about like Casey, because Casey used to know Roman.
Oh yeah,
and Roman did Coliseum Records, right? And Roman released my first King Quartz album, Photoshop, where I was more like vapor wavy kind of cloud rap type shit. Like it was just it was Black Toad stuff, right?
Nice.
And
hazy wavy hip hop.
Yeah, but like then Roman deleted every single thing. But like I never actually got a copy of that album, even though it like sold out and stuff. I was never given a copy of that album.
Is it still available somewhere, like online, or
I
does
don't know.
Somebody have a physical I somewhere?
I don't know.
Can I ask somebody. You about the songwriting process for actually some of the songs like Sad Cigarette, which, you know, obviously having a little bit more of a gothy feel to them. Is there any particular artists that you listen to that inspire you when you're making that kind of music? Or, you know, that sort of vibe?
I think for that, it was more just like, I was just tapping into my more spooky vibe.
A little goblin vibe.
Do you do more songs like that?
Yeah, I've done a bunch. I mean, like on the 33rd split, like we didn't talk about this. Is me and VCR Headaches.
Yeah.
Shut up. And VCR Headaches is coming with me to St. Louis. And like, we just like to make spooky shit. Like, I just like to make spooky shit. But like I just decided to put it into my King Quartz like repertoire, I guess, instead of like having another alias where I'm gonna make spooky music under a different name. Yeah. I was just like I'm just gonna introduce it into this.
I feel like people do too many aliases. I think that you should kinda just do it under the same name once in a while, you know, instead of
if you wanna change your shit up, do it. You're the boss.
Yeah. Yeah, I was just like, whatever. I'm just gonna put out like this weird kind of like goth vapor post punk thing.
Definitely a post punk vibe to that.
I refer to it as hypnotic pop.
I'll take it. Like people can call it whatever they want. I'm never gonna call it whatever you want. I'm down with it.
Who are some people you would like to collaborate with?
Uh,
everything is on the table. Even people that maybe wouldn't possibly have a shot at.
No, I'm like, I actually don't want to collaborate with anyone at the moment. I kind of want to, like, do my thing. And, like, get a good opportunity to maybe earn some collaborations. But there's, like, I don't want to collaborate with anyone right now. I kind of want to just put out completely me.
Yeah.
I like that.
Yeah, I know it's a boring answer, but, like, kind of that's, like,
it's a real answer.
But that's just kind of how my vibe has been lately. It's just, like, I just want to do my own thing. And if that works, then maybe I can collab with some people. Like, you know.
I'll take it. Tell me a little bit about some things about the, I mean, we all know about the vaporwave scene, right? That's kind of where we're from. What are some things about the metal scene or the hip hop scene or another scene that you're involved in that you wish that you could change about how that scene operates?
I think all scenes are kind of the same, really. Like, people just, I don't want to talk like an overlord, but like, there is just a thing where like, there's always going to be those people in any scene, no matter what scene it is, that just want to appear like the loudest voice in the room.
Yeah.
And I just kind of don't like those kind of personalities personally.
Yeah.
I got like, you. People that always have to have the spotlight on them.
Yeah. It's like you can get so much accomplished without being that loud, you know?
Well said. Sometimes you got to make moves in silence.
Like, I'm not the loudest voice in the room, but, like, I'm not doing that bad myself. Like, just, like, I'm kind of out here, but I don't need to always scream and be like, notice me. Let's take photos together and take photos of me. And, like, there's a lot of that in any scene where there's someone that's just, like, there to be like, I want to be noticed. And it can be an artist or just an influencer, but it's just like, I don't really care for people that give a fuck about that. Because I'm like, I don't really need to be in the spotlight. I don't need photos to be taken of me. Like, just let me do my thing, you know?
You're interested in the substance, the real meat.
Yeah. 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 I just put out good ass art and I created a mantra when I started King Quartz, and it's just, the mantra is, it's all about the feeling. So if the feeling isn't there, then there's no point.
Yeah.
But like, there's no feeling in like trying to get this social media presence, but then your life lacks substance. Like there's no feeling there.
So do you feel that?
I
feel so bad. I keep interrupting you. My bad. I'm just thinking out loud. Do you notice or ever feel that there's a lot of gatekeeping going on with some of those louder voices, or would it be a stretch to
I don't know make if that there's conclusion? Gatekeeping. I don't know if there's gatekeeping. Wouldn't necessarily call it that. I think there's just like when you're interacting with people consistently, you want to keep them around, right?
Yeah.
And so if you're interacting consistently with these people and you create something great, why let new ones in? It's like we've already got a system that works.
Yeah, that's kind of what it is. It's not even like gatekeeping on purpose. It's like, oh, you know, we know what
if
we're doing.
If it ain't broke, don't fix it.
Yeah, but that's not good.
Yeah,
that's an interesting perspective and the way to describe it. And I think you're right. I think that does happen a lot. They don't even realize they're doing it. They just don't want to. They just like what they have.
They just want to keep their circle small, maybe.
That makes sense. Well, people kind of just like what they have. They get used to what they have. They like the way things are run, and they don't want to change it. And that's kind of like a typical
thing
in general,
right?
Well, you can 100% fault them for that because they're just keeping stale.
I could see the benefits and the drawbacks. Overall, I think there's more drawbacks to that than there are benefits.
Or afraid that someone will shake things up and then they'll have to catch up to some new idea.
I think, you know, and Ronnie's stating in chat, I think it's good to be open to what the kids are doing, you know? And I don't think any of us have a problem with that. But
absolutely.
Like, yeah, definitely.
No, I don't have a problem.
Yeah, if we're involved in art and music and, like, staying abreast of what's going on, like, you can't get stale, you know?
Yeah, there's the impetus to change anything.
But I have seen it just, like, in the music business, the bar business, like, everything. Yeah. It's like, once you get your solid five, I've seen a lot of circles just tighten up, and it's just like, nope, you're not getting it. You know?
Yeah, that's a very interesting perspective, and it's 100% true.
Yeah, and so that exists in, like, so many different industries, where it's just like, once you got a program that is not breakable, and it's just making you successful more and more and more, it's just like, why bring in someone new? So it's like, I can't get mad at someone for that, because they're like, yo, I've got it figured out. You need to figure it out yourself. Like, make your own group.
All right.
You know?
Interesting. Okay.
So I don't get mad at people for that when they're gatekeeping, if it's, like, in terms of success, because it's like, I get it. Like, you figured it out. So
I was thinking of it in terms of, like, an entire scene, like a movement or whatever.
I'm trying to hear the benefits and drawbacks. As opposed to, like, I hear you both.
Like a small group. Like, I was thinking of it as, like, it's, like, just a way of thinking for, like, a bunch of people
big group,
in charge of it.
The big group. I mean, I got banned from Universal Records, bro.
Oh, you got banned from Universal Records? What happened?
Yeah. I mean, my band fucked up.
Your band from Universal Records. What? Do you want to elaborate on that, or can you not?
I probably shouldn't.
You don't have to. But this is kind of an interesting statement.
That's
that you just
a hot take.
This is kind of an interesting thing to say.
Gotta get the flames going.
It happened when I was 18.
Oh, okay, I got you. This is a lot of responsibility.
So the non-disclosure agreement has definitely expired.
Yeah, well, you know, I've said enough.
He's said enough.
Like, but yeah, you'll never see me be a pop star. That's for fucking sure.
I'll take it. So, all right, let's go back to, like, something a little more lighthearted. If you had to put a name, if you had to name, like, a favorite act, album, or genre, you can pick one. How did you discover that act, album, or genre that you would consider, like, your favorite?
I don't even know how to answer that question, honestly.
Well, it's a pretty broad question, but, like, whatever comes to mind.
My favorite anything. Basically.
Yeah, you know what? If you can't think off the top of your head of a favorite act, maybe it's an album that was really monumental to you, or maybe it's just an entire style of music. I feel like you may have touched on this a little bit earlier, but I think those stories are super magical, and I like to hear them.
Like something that, like, kind of defined something for me.
Yeah, that like moment when you discovered it, if you remember it, like.
Yeah, I mean, that kind of happened, like, when I earlier touched on, like, the LimeWire, when I found, like, death metal on accident, because I was just a little edgy goth lord.
There
and
you
it was
go.
Just, like, typing in death, and then I find that death metal is a thing that exists.
You literally, like, searched it, and that was what got you there.
Yeah. Because I wasn't looking for, like, death in, like, a way, like, oh, I want to see videos of people dying. I was just, like, a dumb little kid who was just like, I want to search for music that sounds like death.
Yeah.
And boom, there it is. I think the other thing, I'm trying to think about a movie. What's your favorite movie, Isaac?
Blade Runner. What's yours?
Like, the original Blade Runner?
I like the, I want to say it's the director's cut, the one that doesn't have the voiceover.
Okay. But the original one?
Yeah, yeah. I think that's the original. Oh, you mean as opposed to Blade Runner 2049? Yes, yes, sir. I like the original Ridley Scott film with Harrison Ford.
Yeah, okay. So my favorite movie is Brick.
Brick. Oh, Brick. From like 2005 or some shit?
Yeah, Joseph Gordon-Levitt.
Joseph Gordon-Levitt, mm-hmm. Yeah. I never saw it, but I heard a lot of good things about it.
That's my favorite movie. And then my second favorite movie is Alien.
Oh, and that's a good one.
I like combining those two ideas together.
I like combining those two ideas together. Isn't Brick like a story about like a kid that... What's the fucking story? Like, it's like... Well, I guess I'll have to watch it at some point.
Yeah, Brick is about... Yeah, it's about like a college student who is worried about his ex-girlfriend who has a drug problem.
I got you.
That's the shortest way to put it. And it just gets... It goes from there.
What would you say to people that say that Aliens is better than Alien?
You're wrong.
You're wrong.
You're wrong. That's an Isaac-ass answer. Good answer. You're objective. That's an objectively bad take.
No, it's just like, you're wrong. I'm sorry. Like, you can disagree with me, but you're wrong.
Well, so you like spooky things. Alien is definitely the spookier of the two. Aliens is like
shot better. I love the tension and the build up. Yeah.
Okay, that's fair.
Aliens is sort of like an adventure movie.
It is. It's
Alien
more of like an action,
interesting horror film.
Yeah, Aliens is not a horror film for sure.
My favorite kind of like thriller movie is like a slow burn. You know,
I agree. Yeah. Okay. Do you consider yourself a fan of genres in general?
I don't have anything wrong with it. Like, I think it helps in searching.
You mention a lot of, like, you said, like, cyber crust. And I'm just like, oh, I live for this. Because personally...
No, I love genres.
Admittedly, I'm asking because I kind of thought you would say that. I think it really helps you find more of what you like.
Yeah, it helps you know something. And also, like, being a musician myself, it's like, you kind of have to make yourself in some way. Mm. You can't just be like, I'm a musician. People are going to be like, what kind of musician? So it's like...
Well, but vaporwave is an interesting genre to pick, though, because it's very difficult to kind of nail down what it even sounds or means, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It is very amorphous.
Yeah, but, like, we now live in the age of microgenres.
True.
Like, I never picked vaporwave myself. I never called myself a vaporwave artist. I just got looped into it. And I was like, I'm not going to say that I'm not. Like, if this community loves me, then I'm going to love it back.
Mm-hmm. Beautiful.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I consider myself to be an... I considered myself to be an outsider for a super long time, but this community just has a way of kind of pulling you in. And just embracing you.
Yeah, sorry to interrupt. But totally agree. It's like the fact that, like, I got... people that loved my music and listened to it and wanted to share it and talk about it. And even the people that hated about it, like saying like, this isn't vaporwave, because there was a lot of that too.
Oh yeah.
Like there was a lot of people being like, he's not vaporwave. And it's like, well, I never called myself that in the first place. So this is all of your fault.
Yeah. Like, it's all your fault.
Like, I never tried to fight to be vaporwave or to not be vaporwave. I was just like, if you want to call me that, I love it. And, like, I love the community that is, like, the actual people that give a fuck about this community.
Yeah, the most interesting way to get involved in it is people that just get pulled into it.
Totally agree.
Yeah. Yeah. It's just, like, dope. Like, I love it. Like, it's just like metal. Like, when you get into the metal scene's really welcoming. Like, everyone wants to have that idea that it's like, oh, it's a bunch of spooky boys in leather that are going to beat you up. But nah, really, they're just a bunch of teddy bears. And they're just going to be like, what up, bro? you know?
Love to hear that. Pacific Plaza's got a great question in chat. Wants to know if you can pair a fancy cocktail with each of your albums, since you are, in fact, a mixologist.
Okay. Neo Tokyo, I think I would do, time to think, because it's very future funky, but futuristic-y. I'd kind of almost wanted to do like a Blanco Tequila Old Fashioned, because it's like...
Ooh, I'll take one of those.
Yeah, so it's like, yeah, Blanco Tequila Old Fashioned, because it's like, it's kind of strong, but it's still clear, and it's just like, man, this is all we got. Like, deal with it. here's a slice of orange to help with it. With Recycle Bin, I think it'd have to probably be like a sidecar, but like part of the glass is broken.
So part like, of the glass drink. Is broken.
Yeah, it's like, don't drink from that side.
Oh, that's like so cool.
You're going to cut your lip. And then with the 33rd split, I think it'd be... I'm trying to think about VCR headaches right now. It'd be like, damn, this is tough, because I'm trying to include VCR into it. It'd be like, there's definitely some beer involved. Some beer involved. Like you have a beer on the side, and then like a shot of probably just like. Some whiskey. Yeah, just like a beer.
Make a michelada.
Nope. Just like, you got like a Miller High Life and like a good whiskey.
VCR headaches. 3-day-old Labatt on the side. Is that how you pronounce that, Labatt? The one with the blue maple leaf,
yeah,
I think,
Canadian,
right?
Yeah, Canadian beer. Labatt. That's everywhere. That's actually what I'm drinking right now.
Bro.
And they have Detroit Labatt here.
So oh,
Labatt
what?
With... Yeah. Bro, I'm right across the street from Canada.
Love, like, just mass-produced, like, shitty lager beer. I can't get enough of it. I don't think Labatt is shitty, but, like, it's just, you know, it's like a working-class beer.
I'm working.
That's a compliment. Let's a Malort shot. Come on.
No,
do you
no
like,
Malort.
Yeah, I think we talked about that in the server already. Big respect to anyone that can stomach. Skelly, have you ever had Malort?
No.
It's terrible.
But okay, got it.
If you go to Chicago, like, right. Oh, man, you got to try our biggest export. It's called Malort. Here, try some. It's like drinking paint thinner.
Okay, got it.
Oh, you want to tell us? Tell us what you do with Malort. You said it in the survey, and it was fucking hilarious.
Oh, man. Yeah, all right. So, like... Should you find yourself in Chicago, you order, like, your buddy goes to the bathroom, right? So you order, like, it's like, we're going to get rounds of whiskey. Let's say you're with four friends. You order 3 shots of whiskey, 1 shot of Malort. The person that comes back from the bathroom, that's their shot. So you all take a shot of whiskey and you're all just like, this is fine. And then the person that takes the shot of Malort is like, why did you just feed me sewage?
Like they don't know, because it looks just like whiskey. You're just like, enjoy your shot, and it's fucking Malort.
They just have the worst time.
I don't know where Lux went. It's a shame, but she actually unironically likes Malort.
Yeah, some people are, you know, they're, what is that called? Is it
a
sadist or a masochist? Masochist?
Masochist.
Yeah, they love the pain.
Yeah, she unironically enjoys it.
People that love Malort make me weary.
Make me weary. As a bartender.
Yeah, I'm just like, why would you do this to yourself?
That's so funny.
Stop, please, I beg of you.
Anything but, please.
Is there anyone in the scene, any of the scenes that you're involved in, that you would consider an idol or a mentor? And if so, who?
Ooh, man. Billions. Like, That's how I even got to the place I'm at, is because I just like I just remember Biggie Smalls with the great line, just like emulate the great. And I think that was my initial like big moment where it's just like, oh yeah, that's what I got to do. So like anyone that inspires me, I want to find a piece of them that I can possibly take in and like carry with myself. So I mean this one band from Norway called Enslaved, like they make black metal, but like it's beautiful and they've changed and they've become progressive and like totally changed their sound, but like they just constantly put out content and they fight the mold. And it's like, that's an inspiring thing to me, is just to be like always change.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
And like other artists, like even George Clanton, for instance, like he used to hit me up and ask me how to tour, and now look at him.
Nice. Yeah.
And so it's that's just very like interesting. And so he's inspired me to be like fucking don't stop. But like I did have to stop for a while just because of a bunch of dumb shit that was happening with my life.
Yeah.
Hmm?
It happens, you know, life happens and we can't take care of other things and we have to take care of ourselves.
Sometimes you gotta pump the brakes.
Your survival mode, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
No one's gonna judge you for circling the wagons.
That's a great Dark Throne album, actually. Circle the
Wagons. A what?
Dark Throne album.
Oh, whoops. Didn't know.
Oh.
I fucked with metalcore a little bit back in the day, but other than that, I'm just kind of a Philistine when it comes to metal. A little bit of grindcore, and that was it.
I'm a Philistine with, like, probably a lot of, like, everything else.
Well, you know, Skelly and I balance each other out pretty well, because all the, like, JRPG and video game stuff, I can field all that. And all the, like, super critically acclaimed Criterion art film shit, he can do that. And the, like, classic, like, music that's, like, older than both of us, he knows all that shit and I don't.
I know some things.
Just trying to read the chat real quick.
Is there I'm sorry. No, please finish that thought.
No, you're good.
Is there a...
you're good.
Like a type of music that you used to really be into that you've just kind of washed your hands of or grew out of? And if so, what is it? And why? I want to know why.
I think the only reason I really got out of metal was because keeping a band together is really difficult.
Yeah.
It's basically
having like four or five dudes be married.
Right.
And and like as you get older, like if that shit doesn't pop when you're like in your early 20s, like it just gets incredibly difficult to start dealing with, because you take on more responsibilities as you get older. So that's why I started focusing more on King Quartz, because it was like I can just be my own solo thing and kind of control it, you know.
Yes.
I don't need to rely on like four other dudes to show up to practice. Like I got this. And so like I guess I kind of like disappeared from metal a little bit. Like I don't pay attention to it as much as I used to, but I still love it, like until the end of my life. Like it shaped me, it gave me so many opportunities, I got so many things from it, but like I really don't have any interest in ever really playing it any.
Wow. So Euphoria doesn't like play shows anymore?
No, that band's gone.
Oh, that band's gone. Damn, I didn't know that.
Like, there's one band that I might join, and that's why I can't talk about it, because it's still just a discussion.
Yeah.
But like that'd be the only band I would want to join. Because like I just really like playing that, like those songs, and like working with them. I'm friends with them. Like I've already played shows with them before. I was never a official member. I'm not on any other albums, but it, like I helped them out with shows and stuff. But like I might join them, but that would be the only time I would consider going back into metal. because it's like I already know those guys have it all together, and nice. They'd be practicing anyways, and like shit's gonna be solid, you know.
Now remind me, you play guitar and bass guitar, right? Or
yeah,
that's right. Very cool. I knew you weren't a drummer, but
I've played drums in bands before.
Oh, you have.
I also play piano. I went to trade Unreal. School for audio mixing and engineering.
Shit.
I play accordion.
Play accordion?
This fool plays accordion. Yeah. Who in vaporwave plays accordion?
How'd you get into the accordion?
Wait, you did say you're German, right? Were you joking around?
No, I'm not joking around. But the accordion story, I'm not going to tell.
I'm not going to tell.
it's just like the Band from Universal story. You can't tell those.
You just sat down and you were like, let me figure this shit out. I'll add it to the list.
You're teasing us with all these crazy stories.
I'm just not telling how I acquired the accordion. I could tell you guys like off feed.
That's okay. Like, don't worry, I'll drop it. But okay.
Yeah, we'll drop it, dude. We've got plenty.
We got it. So we got. But hold on, I have a question I want to ask you now. Remember now. Keep doing another question.
I just like to know, like, if you have any musical. First of all, do you believe in guilty pleasures? Whether you do or don't, I want to know if you have a musical guilty pleasure you want to share with us.
Savage Garden.
Oh, interesting.
Boy, they were all over the mall when we were kids.
Yeah. Yeah, it's truly, madly, deeply, dude. That song slaps.
Wow. Good choice.
We were talking about Sugar choice. Ray on our last episode, so I'll take it.
Yeah, that's right.
I will say Sugar Ray is so far from a guilty pleasure. I'd say it's a please go away forever kind of song.
Wow, unreal. Is there...
Wait, did I offend one of you two?
No, it wasn't me that said it.
First of all, what did you say earlier? If you don't like it, you're wrong. That's me to a T. So, like, it's okay. You can be wrong, buddy. And, you know, I say that from a place of love. Obviously, I don't actually believe that, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
Is there anything?
I'm just being silly, too. I'm not trying to, like, say I hate you if you like Sugar. I'm just being foolish.
Yeah, I mean, listen, there's
a
lot of...
But if you like Sugar Ray, you suck!
You suck. You can fuck out of here. What is... I mean, you're into some pretty... We all are into some pretty weird shit. What is the, like, absolute weirdest, like, can't really show it to anybody, like, weirdest shit, scare the hose music that you're into?
Wait, what did you say?
Like, hoe scaring music.
What the fuck is hoe scaring?
You never heard, I am a simple man. I see hoes, I scare them.
Hoe scaring?
Somebody like, turn off Aphex Twin. You're scaring Peepaw.
What's a really difficult band for you to share with people that you think like, oh, I don't think anyone would like this if I play it? I think is what Isaac's trying to say. Like, what's a good thing? Like, what's something you're like, oh man, this is the weirdest music I listen to.
Yeah, that's what I want to know. Hoe scaring jams.
It's just trying to say like what's like something that's like so weird that you don't really play it for anybody because you think they'll just think you're really like off beat. You're too quirky. I don't know.
Clowncore.
Everybody
loves Clowncore.
What's the band right now?
You'd
duo.
Be surprised, bud.
What's that duo? The Clowncore duo. They call.
Are you talking about 100 Gex?
No, Clowncore. They're like fucking amazing.
I'm just kidding.
Too.
Yeah, they're like always filming their videos.
Oh, they're called Clowncore, of course. They're called Clowncore. Yeah. So I thought like
get some rest.
What's that
Skelly.
Band that's in the Clowncore? I'm like, oh, it's called Clowncore. They're fucking outstanding. Yeah.
They're
that
cool as shit.
Is fucking amazing. I've watched like so many of their stuff, and they're touring right now too. I think.
Wait, I'm responding to something. Someone said Typo Negative is the ultimate hoe scaring band. I have to disagree so hard. If you ever are around goth people and you put on Typo Negative, the hoes come out.
We had Male Tears in here for a hot second. I don't know if he's still in
that
here.
That is not hoe scaring.
Man,
shout out goth.
I love Clowncore. This is such an interesting act. And like it's so funny the way that like you think it's going to be silly, but it's really crazy, complex sort of sound textures and ideas.
Yeah.
And, oh, man, they're great. And this is a really
I just love how energetic it is.
You watch the Clown Quarter videos, John Shiro?
Yeah, a little bit. I mean, they're always filmed in phenomenal. That like van.
Yeah, they're
I
so
love
fun.
Drummers, dude.
Oh,
I
you need
drum.
To watch the ones that were. Wait, I'm sorry, but Shiro, you need to watch the ones that are filmed in the outhouse.
Yeah,
in the outhouse.
That would be a host scaring van. Yeah, I agree. That's a host scaring van.
Depends on.
I mean, since we're using that term, like, I don't like using that term, but here we are.
Admittedly, I don't. I mean, I'm a feminist. I'm an avowed feminist, but like it's an internet phrase, like scare the hose. Like, hey, turn that off. You're scaring the hose. You know, like
Young Shiro. That's gonna be the quote underneath your name now. Avowed feminist.
Shiro
Young Shiro.
Canceled. Avowed feminist. Don't
avowed
scare
feminist.
The hose.
No, avowed feminist. Like DJ. Yeah. Vaporwave influencer, avowed feminist. You know, we're gonna have that.
All right, so let's do deep cuts. What's an act that you are into that you can guarantee that like nobody's heard of?
Wait, what? Repeat that. You just
like,
glitched out. I'm
like,
sorry.
Oh, my bad. You know, like when you want to recommend an artist or something to somebody and you like, I know this shit is not on Spotify. I can guarantee you if you Google it, you're going to have trouble finding it. What is like the most obscure act that you like, that you really like, but you can guarantee that none of us, nobody in chat has ever heard of them?
I think the sad thing is like, everyone's going to know it. So I don't know if I need to give it, but I'd just say like Encarta 95 is great.
Oh, love Encarta 95.
Do you mean
love.
Sterling, right? Encarta 95?
I don't know them personally.
Like from, I think that's Encarta 95. I don't know. It's late.
I don't know them personally, but like I've returned to that a lot.
Yeah.
Wow. That's interesting. That's great. Great act. Love Encarta.
With an I, right? Encarta.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know, I don't think we've really gotten into what some of your we've talked a lot about the metal and the hip hop. What are some of your favorite vaporwave acts? Like what do you maintain are like the must hears?
Ooh. Man, I'm sorry for dead air right there.
That's cool.
Dead air never hurt anybody. There's a great Luxury Noise song playing in the background, so it's fine.
That's like, no, I can't even. You should have asked me that to be ready for that type of question.
I tend to have a bad habit of doing that.
No,
I
can't even give you an answer because, like, I'm gonna say things, and then like tomorrow I'm gonna be like, wait.
We had a guest do that. I think it was Drink Your Tears. And she was like, I actually had all these questions prepared that I would like to address. And then she put them up on like Twitter or Facebook, and it was awesome.
Yeah.
Like an addendum to the episode.
Yeah. I mean, I can do that in like the Discord or something, but yeah.
Yeah. Love having you in there, by the way. If any of you guys are thinking about joining a group of friends or just a community of people that, you know, are comfortable with arguing, debating, and just geeking out about random things, jump in the Discord server. We'd love to have you guys. Hell yeah, Syllabus. What's up? Thank you. Okay,
did
well,
my
no
video
worries.
Just fuck up for a second?
No, you're here. You're here, bud. You know, you'll probably think of something that you want to maybe drop in the Discord server
that's
later.
That's just a deep question. That's just a very deep question. It's hard to pick your favorite artist when you are one.
It
you
is.
Know?
Yeah.
Admittedly, I couldn't do it. Well,
and so like that's why like I don't want to say like names and then be like, wait, all these other names too.
Yeah.
Well, so anyone watching, or obviously if you're listening to the podcast, you'll want to search us on socials, follow our link tree, check us out, and anyone that's a live viewer, if you want to get more exclusive King Quartz content, you might just find some of it in the following days on Discord. No guarantees, but you just might.
I'll be around. I ain't leaving.
Hell yeah. Skelly, you had a question you were like thinking of.
Oh, I don't remember it now. You don't remember? I'm going to have to go to the Discord for that one too. But we are getting late now. So
it is getting to the end.
Yeah.
We do love
like 6 minutes or so.
Yeah, yeah. We do love to give our guests the floor for the, you know, the remaining few minutes, because Chris and I will kind of mention some stuff that we've got in the works, and then maybe we'll name drop our next guest. But until we do that, anything you want to say as far as self promo, shouting people out, upcoming shows or album drops, let's hear it all.
Yeah, I mean, I have a bunch of new music that is in the works with me and VCR Headaches. We got a show coming up in St. Louis with Vapor Space. That's at Platypus on April 7th. And besides that, I don't know. Just check me out, man. That's
we
it.
Will
That's
find
it.
A way to get Skylines back on SoundCloud so all you people can hear it.
Yeah, and please send me that.
Oh, I will upload it and probably send you a link like right after this is finished. So, if you're in the St. Louis
Love
area,
you too, VCR Headaches.
Shout out VCR Headaches. If you're in the St. Louis area, April 7th, Platypus is a great venue. Ronnie is an excellent promoter, excellent show organizer, and just person all around. Very good at elevating voices and just bringing people together. Can't say enough wonderful things about that man. Go see King Quartz, VCR Headaches, Sound Market, and Oipi on April 7th in St. Louis at Platypus.
Gonna bang.
It's gonna bang. They're gonna have dancers. I hope that's not something that I wasn't supposed to reveal. I love how I just said it.
Yeah. We've got choreography for me and VCR Headaches show. Bringing
what,
in professional
what other
dancers.
What other vaporwave show are you going to see professional choreo? You got to be there.
Hope so. I mean, yeah, it's gonna be sick.
I'll just put out really quick. Got a DJ set I did for Vapor Shave. Shout out Daydream Deluxe and Utopia District, especially Indie Advance, good friend of the show, and the guy that does all our screen captures so we can put them on YouTube. I did an 80s R&B DJ set with some smooth jazz influence. It played during the pre-roll. Part of it did. You can find that on YouTube. Luxury Noise, you're a doll. Thank you for that. The set is very poignant, very romantic, full of, if you like vaporwave, it's full of a lot of the source material, and you should go check it out. I've got it on YouTube and SoundCloud. I've just been scouted by Ming Curry for the upcoming, yikes, I hope I haven't said too much already. We've got an upcoming event that is being put on by somebody very, very dear to the scene, and I submitted a 20-minute cloud rap set with a song that King Quartz is in. A rare one that's really good. Big fan. Very excited about that. Got some great shows in the works coming up this summer, but can't say shit about them. And the fall. Can't say a word. Mum's the word.
Gotta keep it secret.
Gotta keep it a secret, but when they drop, all hell is gonna break loose.
Oh, yeah.
And that's it for me. Skelly, what have you got in the works, buddy?
I mean, not too much. I have the new song, Price I Pay, which is on the Coast to Coast compilation, and it's now on streaming services. You can, of course, purchase Glows Then Melt on vinyl from Needle Juice Records in the variant of Blood Splatter or Glow in the Dark. As regards to live things, my new party is Eclipse, and that will be on 428, and that is it's going to be at the 700 in Philadelphia, and I'll be playing Witch House and Wave and Funk and some dark pop music, like, you know, Grimes and Churches and stuff. And then Terminally Chill returns to the Dolphin in Philadelphia on 5-4, and I'll be DJing that along with Mr. Hideyoshi and Vape Error. And I'm going to start doing that party regularly again. And so come. Those are really good parties. Everybody comes and has a good time and dances, and you will have a good time, too, if you come to them. This is my parties.
Fuck yeah.
I'm glad you've got like a dark goth party and like a fun party. Like, you've got kind of both going on.
Yeah, but I don't consider the dark one exactly a goth party, because I play the stuff that the goth parties don't play. They play new wave. They play, you know, like the
EBM.
EBM. They play that stuff. There's like a million
mid-tempo
parties that do that. I will be playing like Witch House. I will be playing Wave.
I would very much like to.
I'll be playing dark synth music like Perturbator and stuff like that, too. You know what I mean?
I would love to play a show like that.
They don't play that music at goth parties.
They don't.
This is like a witchy party then, kind of really.
Nice.
Avugongo play like... You know,
shit, and that's at a club called the 700?
The 700, yeah.
700. Mm-hmm. You got to go. Well, that's about it for us tonight. Do we have a confirmation on our next guest?
It's Geometro.
Geometro.
Dear friend. Yes.
Geometro is kind of involved in the Philly scene, no?
Big involved.
I want to say they do some stuff with Virtua 94, right?
They've done some terminally chill parties multiple times. They'll do more in the future.
Very excited to get Geometro on the show. Until then, guys, thank you so much for being here. Thank you, King Quartz. I've wanted to talk to you for ages, and I'm over the moon that you joined us tonight. I loved picking your brain, and I hope you had a good time.
I did. I hope you guys had a good time talking with me.
Absolutely. Thank you, chat, for being here. Whether you're new or whether you're a regular, we welcome you to the Hot Takes Horde. And I'll drop it one more time before we go and roll the trailer. Jump in our Discord server. It's a lot of fun. Until next week, we'll see you all at 9 p.m. Eastern on Monday, April 10th, with Geometro. Geometro, and that's only on Hot Takes. Good night, everybody.
It's a hot take.
So, I have a hot take for you.
My hot take? Well, I think some artists need to put a little more energy in their live sets.
Overly complicated tracks are things that that kind of ruin a track for me.
Don't stick to any kind of genre label.
Future bass is the worst music genre ever created.
Damn! Barber beats was the original vaporwave.
Fuck General MIDI Choir, it's all bad.
Bruh.
Worst album artwork I've ever seen is Green Day's Father of All Motherfuckers, probably.
I find new music often, and I usually illegally download it.
Stuff that sounds good.
Sampleless vaporwave is still vaporwave, buddy.
MIDI wave is a form of vaporwave. Deal with it.
Gen Z is the future of vaporwave. I said it.
What is your musical guilty pleasure, vaporer?
It's gotta be K-pop.
If you don't like mint chocolate chip ice cream, you are a vape.
Music isn't real.
I smell weed.
I'm Dan Mason.
This is Babe Eric.
This is FM Skyline.
This is Mesh.
Yo, this is Groovy Kaiju.
This is Christ. You're listening to
Hot Takes.
That's the one.
Don't touch my records. Ever.